this system that Trump exploited, doing such horrendous things to our immigrant communities and refugee communities across the United States, wasn't something he built. He inherited it through previous administrations. We fought like hell for the past 4 years. From day one to the very last day, we'll continue to fight.
Today is not the end.
But we're not looking at this as a sigh of relief. This is actually a moment where we're gearing up to fight even harder than we did in the past 4 years to finally see the justice that we've been fighting for.
Hey, it's Murad Awada, co-executive director at the New York Immigration Coalition. The NYC is an umbrella advocacy and policy organization that represents over 200 immigrant and refugee groups in the state of New York.
Hi, I'm Isa Noyola, the deputy director at Mi Gente. We are a base building, power building organization for Latinx communities in the United States, and we are fighting to end the criminalization of all of our people, all of our gente.
My name's Amaha Kasa. I'm the executive director of African Communities Together. We organize African immigrants to get access to services, develop as leaders, and speak up on the issues that affect our communities.
Hello, I'm Jamil Smith, senior writer at Rolling Stone. Now that Joe Biden and Kamala Harris will be headed to the White House in January, we at Rolling Stone are taking a look back at the tumultuous Trump years and a look forward to the Biden presidency and wondering what this will all mean for those seeking a better future here in the United States. Welcome to the third and final discussion in our series about the future of immigration. You can find our previous two conversations now on rollingstone.com and on YouTube. Today, we're speaking with immigrant rights movement leaders about where they are currently focusing their nationwide efforts. First, some context. It's been a long 4 years under Trump. Deportations were rampant under former President Obama, of course. But while some immigration issues like DACA can be addressed right away when President-elect Biden takes office in January, there are so many others that have come up during this president administration that are going to face long battles to resolve ahead. Now, refugee resettlement has dwindled from 110,000 people per year to 15,000 per year under soon-to-be former President Trump. His administration, even in its last days, is working to phase out temporary protected status, or TPS. Tens of thousands of asylum seekers have had to wait in Mexico for their hearings in the U.S., and hundreds of children were separated from their parents with no government plan to reunite them. The list goes on. The tangled web of rules and realities left behind by Trump will be difficult to undo, and how far a Biden administration will be willing to go on immigration reform likely depends on the movement that our panelists today are leading. Where were you when you first got word that Joe Biden had won the presidency, and what did you do next?
I was with my family in Northern Virginia, and we had been watching the results roll in over the last few days, and in particular, my nephew is a very avid, you know, sort of history and civics buff, and has been, you know, doing his map, his electoral maps and all of that. And so, I think when I got the news, I nodded, you know, I exhaled a little bit, and I started, you know, thinking even harder about what are the next steps that we're going to have to take over the next 4 years to reverse the damage that has been done to the system of legal immigration in this country, to the lives and well-being of immigrants in this country, documented, undocumented.
Yeah, I think that sense of relief was palpable. I think there are a lot of, obviously there's joy in the streets throughout cities in America, but I think that sense of relief, I know I felt it more than joy. What about the rest of you?
I was in Phoenix, Arizona, and it was a sense of, I mean, I've been holding my breath for the past 4 years, ever since this new administration came in, you know, because so much of our work is to hold space for our community members and to lead and show up in a powerful way, offering hope. The last 4 years has just been so incredibly challenging, and I remember just feeling that Saturday morning afternoon. Yeah, it was definitely a sigh of relief mixed with still like, kind of uncertainty mixed in, of just what's ahead, knowing the devastation that has taken place, not just in the last 4 years, but just so much injustice has not been resolved, even prior to the Trump administration. A couple of days before we, I have the tradition of observing Dia de los Muertos, and part of that is honoring ancestors and so many people that we've lost, and even in just recognizing this year alone of the devastating toll that's taken on immigrant communities, trans communities, it's been a lot of holding and sorrow. So it's been a process of decompressing, of celebrating the wins and having joy. It was beautiful to see all the cities around the country and even around the world just rejoice and share some joy that we haven't felt in a while.
I was actually on my way in a cab to a rally we were organizing to protect the results of the election. And, we were heading there about 2 hours in advance to help with setup. And once we, were about 25 minutes away from the site, which was in Columbus Circle here in New York City, something happened where every car around us and people in the streets were just celebrating and cheering. And then I quickly saw that I had gotten a push notification saying that Biden had been declared the winner. I think in that moment, I had a huge sense of optimistic relief. But it was also like cautious, right? Like, I don't want to set up unreasonable expectations in this moment either. Understanding that this system that Trump exploited doing such horrendous things to our immigrant communities and refugee communities across the United States wasn't something he built. He inherited it through previous administrations. So we took that day to celebrate. We fought like hell for the past 4 years. From day one to the very last day, we'll continue to fight. But we're not looking at this as a sigh of relief. This is actually a moment where we're gearing up to fight even harder than we did in the past 4 years to finally see the justice that we've been fighting for.
Tell me a little bit more about those systemic flaws, those things that Trump inherited that he exploited. I call them holes in the boat, these faults, either whether they be in the Constitution, whether they be in, in federal or state or local laws. What kinds of things that he find in particular that you find that can be reparable either quickly or we really need to work for maybe generations to fix?
So for decades, the immigration system here in the United States has been completely unjust and arcane, to say the least, right? The family separation model was created under President Obama, unfortunately. And it wasn't as bad as it was under Trump, but that's just one example of how Trump took it to the next level of separating families. The immigration system in itself is not a truly just system. We have a system that continuously separates families, harms communities. We saw ICE that was built up post DHS that was created after 9/11, and ICE that sat right under it. And under each administration, including under the Trump administration, that agency continued to grow. We saw them act incredibly lawless these past 4 years. And not only that, but like over the past couple of decades, we've invested billions upon billions of dollars on militarizing our southern border to criminalize individuals seeking refuge. So what Trump ended up using was decades old of system errors and flaws to rally his base. One of his first promises was building a wall and forcing Mexico to pay for it. The funny part about it is that there is a fence that he's been building that actually fell during a storm. But he did build a different type of wall with the Remain in Mexico program, where you saw countless of asylum seekers, tens of thousands of asylum seekers who ended up getting stuck in Mexico and pretty much trapped because of this program that was created with the intent of, you know, firming up our southern border and not allowing people to cross anymore.
The history and the story of immigration here is one of primarily of exploitation and of, you know, it's been informed because of various other systems of oppression, right? And other ways that immigration alone, in terms of how we've constructed it, has grown and exploited human labor, has exploited human migration, right? And so when you mix in capitalism, when you mix in transphobia, when you mix in xenophobia and all of these isms, that it is no surprise that Trump inherited was, you know, an immigration system that was on already on, you know, harming communities and actually doing exactly what it's supposed to do, you know. And so, you know, I've done many detention center visits, and they all are actually running the same way, and they're all actually torturing human beings every single day in cages. And that's not on accident, and that's not a mistake. That's very much intentional. And the point for this administration has always been cruelty. And the point of detention centers and borders and family separation has been cruelty. And to minimize and to take away human dignity. And so I, you know, as an organizer, I am guided by hope in our communities in the way that they resist. I've seen that when the caravans were coming through at the border. Where there is no way, people find a way. You know, people from Honduras were actively fleeing during the election, even with all the rhetoric, even with all of the vitriol and hate, right? That migration has always been a natural pattern of every civilization, every in our humanity. And so I think that, you know, there's so much yet to be seen. I know that our communities are poised to resist. They've demonstrated that over and over and time again, where whether it's been the Democratic Party or even the Republican Party has counted us short. We've always shown up in a powerful way. With very little resources, we've shown up to demonstrate that we can build power and that we have a voice, and that in that voice, we continue to resist the systems that harm us, that criminalize us, that target us, right? And we only know these systems are going to increase because of surveillance, because of technology, the way that they're becoming more sophisticated, and not necessarily in these like obvious ways that we're kind of used to.
Amaha, what kind of particular challenges have immigrants from the African continent faced during these past 4 years?
African immigrants have really been in the middle of the crosshairs for every initiative that this administration has undertaken to criminalize, to illegalize, to ban and bar and lock up immigrant communities. You know, we saw that starting with the Muslim ban, which could also have been called an African ban, right? It touched countries like Somalia, Sudan. And, you know, we saw that with the slur of calling our homelands shithole countries, or saying about Nigerians, you know, once they come here, they're never going to want to go back to their huts. Right. So that kind of rhetoric, which frankly, a lot of us recognized as the rhetoric of ethnic cleansing, and really harkened back to, attempted genocides that we've seen, you know, genocides and attempted genocides that we've seen throughout the history of this continent and our country, continent of birth. That was the most visible part of it. But we've seen on every level, right? You know, the vast majority of the migrants coming across the southern border are from the Americas. Increasingly, we're seeing refugees from countries like Eritrea or Cameroon, who are also locked up and locked out at the southern border. The ban this year, which excluded the relatives of U.S. citizens from migrating legally if they're from certain targeted countries, including Nigeria and Eritrea. Those were all parts and parcel of it. The stripping legal status away from hundreds of thousands of migrants with temporary protected status, that touched countries like Sudan and Haiti as well as Central American countries. So really, you know, anti-blackness as much as xenophobia has been a part of this administration's, of the Trump doctrine when it comes to immigration. And just hearkening back to some of the points that Murad and Issa made, you know, in your question about what is the system that this president you know, inherited and expanded, it's really a system where corporations can freely cross borders, capital can freely cross borders, information, goods can flow across borders, but where people who are looking for safety, who are looking for opportunity, freedom, you know, a better life for themselves and their families, looking to reunite with their families, where, you know, they are made to bear the burden of proof that they have a right to migrate. You know, the truth is that the immigration system in this country has never really sought to lock out all immigrants, because our economy would grind to a halt. Our Social Security would fail. You know, the labor, including the, you know, so-called essential workers that we've been dependent on throughout the COVID pandemic, who are really essential workers at any time, whether we're in the midst of a pandemic or not, none of those systems could operate. So when we talk about immigrant exclusion, really what that's seeking to do is not to keep out immigrant workers, but to ensure that they don't have the social and economic power to bargain better wages for themselves and a dignity on the job, and that they're excluded from citizenship. And underlying that, we really have a panic about the demographic future of this country. A conservative and wealthy white elite sees the writing on the wall and sees that in the near future this will not be a white majority country. That's what we saw in Charlottesville when people were chanting, you know, about Jewish refugee resettlement agencies. Jews will not replace us, right? It's that fear of an alliance amongst the people who remember their heritage and who are cognizant of the way that the system of migration and white supremacy that underlies it is oppressive and want to work to undo it. So that was but we have a lot of work to do to realize that promise, that, you know, what they see as a threat, we see as a promise of a better, more inclusive future. We have a lot of work ahead to realize that future.
I couldn't agree more. The system has always been about not allowing our humanity to fully shine and fulfill itself. As I interviewed and spoke to, you know, hundreds of asylees who are either on the journey or at the border or inside detention, or even after detention, post detention, that they have longings and wishes of having a healthy life and, you know, free from violence, free from discrimination, all the things. And they've only been met with that at exponential levels each and every single step of the way. And so to have folks still have hope in detention, to still have hope at the border, to still try to figure out how to resist in these uncertain times where so much of this hate has been spread through the media and, you know, in the streets even, that it continues to, I think, fuel our community and our movement to find justice in all of these issues and all of the injustices that have happened, all of the deaths, all of the murders. I mean, up until this point, ICE has not taken accountability for all of the deaths, and CBP has not taken accountability to all the deaths that have happened along the border, inside detention of young children, of women, of men, of trans folks, LGBT folks. So there is so much work to do.
Trump also did something that was quite unique in a way where he emboldened people who used to march around with hoods on to come out without their hoods. He also did that within the halls of power, where we saw him really embolden his wing of the party to actually say what they never wanted to. You know, Amaha was hinting towards this before and saying, you know, immigration's great for the nation. It's just not the, the folks that they're thinking of to come in. And Trump said a number of times that he wanted more white Europeans coming to the nation, right? And that in itself illustrates to you the underlying racial bias and underlying racism that we were dealing with and continue to deal with in this situation that we've been in for the past 4 years, but also the past 20 years before that. We have to acknowledge the harm that has happened since Trump came in. He delivered on almost every single one of his promises. When he said that he wanted to ban Muslims, he did that on literally, I think, day number two. And it was in effect almost immediately, right? And we rallied at JFK to really free the folks who were being detained and about to be deported. And then since then, he's literally jumped on every single aspect of government to ensure that he can isolate immigrants from trying to rig the census, which is like a count of how many people are in the United States, to going in after the asylum system, which was already unjust from before, and making it even more unjust, and really rigging the immigration justice system. So we have seen over the past 4 years something that you can take a broken clock and it'll still be broken, but he broke the clock multiple times over to ensure that it's just not operable. And that's where we're at right now. And we're looking at the Biden-Harris administration coming in this upcoming year to really start thinking about how they're going to reform this system in a way that's going to make sense and that's going to be equitable and fair. But on day one, they really need to roll back every single one of Trump's anti-immigrant executive orders and really begin to think about what does immigration look like and work with partners and advocates across the nation to ensure that we're not negotiating one community away for another. And to make sure that when we talk about letting our folks in, we're talking about rescinding the Muslim ban on day one, but also reinstating DACA and TPS on day one, and thinking about how the fixes, how the administration can fix the technicalities that the pretty much white supremacist administration of Donald Trump has put in place to rig a system to ensure that people continuously fail and then are separated from their families.
What kind of challenges specifically have arisen in these past 4 years, new challenges, and how have you maybe grown as a result of those as a movement leader?
There's the stuff that makes the headlines, right? The stuff that's but it's really the tip of the iceberg, right? It's that's the kids in cages and kind of the spectacular cruelty of the family separation policy as it was enacted under the Trump administration, the Muslim ban, you know, a handful of high profile raids, the building of the wall, but under the waterline, really, the administration and its appointees and its allies in Congress have taken a sledgehammer to the entire system the entire immigration legal system, the system of immigration benefits. Agencies like USCIS, which are supposed to be helping people become citizens, adjust their status, get rights that they're entitled to under law, have become obstructionist. They, you know, routinely deny cases that have merit, you know, that for no good reason, just to delay and draw out the process by which people can become citizens. The asylum system, we've made a couple references to it, but asylum cases are now extended for, you know, multiple years, or people arrive here and with no time to prepare, they're shoved in and no real opportunity for due process or to build a case or to find a lawyer, they're shoved in front of a lawyer, in front of a judge. You know, someone once referred to immigration court as a place where you have death penalty cases with all the protections of traffic court. And that's an accurate description, right? It's matters of life and death, where you know, we've seen this cruel farce play out where children are being expected to represent themselves in immigration court, and you know, it's a cruel joke, and it's the only way to describe that. You know, that's and you know, we heard references to the really the you know, sort of paramilitary or vigilante culture in agencies like CBP and ICE, right, that was really given free rein by this administration. You know, you're going to have to see, they are rotted through with white supremacy, with hatred for immigrant communities, with just a culture of impunity where people where rights are violated. So none of that is that, you know, there are things that the Biden-Harris administration can do on day one using their executive powers, right? They can take put a moratorium in place on deportations. They can reverse these executive orders. A lot of this rot runs deep, not just through enforcement agencies, not just through the immigration detention centers, which, you know, need to be emptied, but through the immigration courts and through the immigration, you know, USCIS, which is supposed to be helping. And every aspect of this system has been weaponized against immigrant communities over the last 4 years. And that's not a ship that you can turn around in the first week or the first 100 days.
The last 4 years is both, I see as a challenge and definitely an opportunity. There's definitely been an absorption moment of young, activists and folks who've been politicized by these last several years, because they want to abolish ICE, because they want to defund the police, because of the actions of this administration has, you know, fueled this fire and rage. And it's a challenge because there is a sort of the understanding, the contextual, the larger picture of what's happened in the past and how we've got here. And so what are the strategic steps? What are the strategic policy wins that go beyond also executive action? Because we also don't want to find ourselves in a place where the pendulum swings on the other side, you know, come 4 years from now, and then we get another set of executive actions at the, you know what I'm saying? And so how do we as a community, as a movement, think about our policy wins in a strategic place? And I say that because if you look at the whole history of immigration, if you look at it through a timeline and see a lot of the statuses, like temporary protective status for, you know, because of environmental catastrophes or for particular regions, we see that they come and go, right? Or, you know, they've been based on labor needs, right? That we've needed folks to build railroads, we needed folks for various sort of things, right? And then they go back, or then they're banned, you know. And so I think what we're looking for as a movement is for something a longer term, you know, a really sort of complete shift of how we think about migration. And that's going to take a while. That's not even thinking past this administration. And I've been in this movement for many, many years. And we keep selling ourselves short in terms of our messaging sometimes. And so there's a big opportunity to actually stick to the larger liberation that our ancestors held, that so many folks are holding in this moment as they continue to journey to the United States.
I think that the past 4 years have taught us how to be more resilient in our advocacy and our fighting for our communities. And, you know, it was one attack after the other, and it was consistent. And it built up our strength as a movement to be able to respond as quickly as we had been able to. And I think through that strength that we have built continuously, and it wasn't just over these past 4 years, it just taught us how to fight differently over the past 4 years. You know, I think that we are in a different place than we were, let's say, you know, in 2016, right before the election. At one point, people, the movement space was really thinking about different ways to protect our community, and temporary statuses were the way of doing that because of how the Senate and the and Congress's makeup were. I don't think that we can do that anymore. And, you know, this goes back to Issa's point of saying we need to think long-term here, and the only real long-term solution is really having a fair and just system and providing freedom and dignity for the 11 million undocumented folks here in the United States, but also what kind of immigration system are we going to have after that? And one that's not exclusionary of folks based on their race or religion, as we've seen that play out over the past 4 years, even more explicitly than it has ever has been in the past. So we really have to take a long, you know, a 20 to 30 look, 20 to 30 year look at how we want to envision this system. But we have to do that within the next couple of years because we don't have an opportunity, and we have to start that process now. I know that Joe Biden and Kamala Harris are not in office yet, but we have to have those conversations yesterday, pretty much. And we've begun the work here in, at the New York Immigration Coalition, and we're going to continue to build with our partners across the state. You know, we also haven't really talked about refugees, and the Trump administration gutted the refugee program so much so that, you know, communities started to rely on those folks to really help the economic engine of the local economies move. And we're expecting that to be rectified as well in this moment, because we can't continuously exclude folks, as especially ones that we've already, like, there are folks already in the hopper, right? Like, they've been stuck in the system for the past couple of years, and this administration has refused to resettle folks here. And the folks who actually hurt were the local communities across the nation. Here in New York, Buffalo, Western New York, Rochester, the Capital Region, those are communities that came back to life after manufacturing left because of the refugee communities here. So I think that that's also on another area that the administration needs to really focus in on. But they can't do this by, they can't do any of this work without actually pausing enforcement and detention. And really understanding that we can't keep perpetuating the worst of the system by saying we're going to fix it, by continuing to do the utmost harm to families, communities, and think that it's going to be okay. So we appreciate the 100, you know, the slowdown or the moratorium on enforcement, but we need to actually stop enforcement in a way that really makes sense, where people who have been held in detention are freed, because we're in a place where we can't continue to perpetuate the worst of everything, which Donald Trump has showed us how bad things can get. And he's actually utilized our communities and our people's bodies as political props for his own ruling of the way that he wanted to show his people his power.
You mentioned refugees. One of the things that we should bring up is climate change, of course, and how that's going to impact what you all do. How have you all incorporated that into your organizing?
Climate change, climate chaos is a current reality that is only going to grow. And if you scratch a lot, scratch the surface of a lot of the humanitarian crises raging around the world right now, from Africa to the Middle East and South Asia, and to Latin America. You know, you don't have to dig very deep to find climate-driven displacement at the heart of a lot of those conflicts. And I think what climate chaos does is lay bare how inadequate Our current commitment is to the goal of humanitarian immigration, right? Which is this is a commitment that dates back to World War II and the Holocaust. That was when really the architecture of refugee resettlement was created. And you know, through the Cold War, when it was very much an extension of U.S. foreign policy, and then really in the late 60s and beyond, where we started to see it really open up and become a vehicle for people who have some of the who are in the center of some of the worst humanitarian crises on the globe, places like Central African Republic or Yemen. That there's some hope, that there's some vehicle for people to resettle and be stable. But the truth is that worldwide, developing countries still do the vast majority of refugee resettlement. It's countries like, Ethiopia, my home country, or Jordan, that are taking in the vast amount of displaced persons. It's great that, that President-elect Biden has committed to, to bring us back to the days where we were resettling 100,000 plus refugees. But that should be really the floor and not the ceiling of our commitment.
We have to talk about climate justice in this moment, where communities that have been used as forms of propelling forward capitalism has really hurt those communities too. And what we've seen is the extraction of wealth from communities across the world to benefit developed nations and then utilize those extracted materials to harm the global environment. And when we're talking about, extraction, look at Bangladesh. They're going to be underwater pretty soon because of the mineral extraction that was happening there. And we haven't really talked about how, U.S. corporations and, military outfits have really exacerbated climate change as well. So the way that we're getting our materials here in the U.S. isn't the most humane or eco-friendly. And it's being produced in other countries, and we're buying it at such low cost because people are suffering elsewhere. And our habits need to also change in this moment when we're talking about climate change, because the U.S. is responsible for a great deal of the global climate crisis that's happening, as we're one of the biggest consumers. And how that reflects back to immigration is, we're going to have a new wave. We've already started to see it, as Amha mentioned earlier, in Yemen and in some other nations, where folks are going to, if they're in agriculture, their crops are going to dry up. But we're also going to see mass flooding. We're going to see towns and villages and cities actually not be able to be inhabited anymore because of the severity of the climate and how it's changing as quickly as it is. We have to take action, but we also have to look out for those who are going to be the most vulnerable, the most marginalized in the world, because we have had a hand at making them the most vulnerable and marginalized.
I want to ask you all about this summer's uprising in the name of, civil rights and against police brutality. How did that, inspire you personally? And also, how maybe were you involved, if you were at all involved with your organizations? And also, I want to ask you, how should your struggles with your organizations work in concert with, Black liberation organizations like Black Lives Matter?
Leading an organization of African immigrants, of Black immigrants, our members were, deeply engaged with this issue, right? Sometimes in the streets, sometimes, in conversations within their communities and their churches and mosques and associations, and around, around the dinner table with their families. It's not a new issue, obviously. The experience that we have with police and law enforcement, as people who move through the world, in black bodies. But there was something different this time. There was something really visceral, about the death of George Floyd. And I think for a lot of our members who are parents themselves, and who are raising black children in the US, when George Floyd cried out for his mother, that broke their heart. It felt like they couldn't breathe themselves. And I think just brought home the need. It sort of broke down a lot of the stories that we tell ourselves about how, you know, if we're just, you know, work hard and, you know, pray and love our families, we can, you know, we can get around these systems, you know, we can get around these systems, we can get over these barriers, and just really brought home the reality that, you know, while a few people may get over these barriers until we bring these barriers down, you know, they're most of us are gonna fall victim to them. So I think that was a really powerful moment of reckoning. You know, it's meant a reckoning for us in terms of rethinking about how we do our work. And, you know, for example, we're doing a lot of work now with connecting our work around immigration bonds and the way that those keep people in immigration detention with the movement to abolish cash bail. People should not be paying, tens of thousands of dollars to for-profit immigration bond companies that require them to pay for their own electronic shackles, which is what's happening now. People mentioned the connection between the demands to defund the police and abolish ICE. Those are really kind of existential challenges, saying, you know, we need to look at what these systems are for and who they serve. And who they oppress, and really rethink, fundamentally rethink and reevaluate these systems and our roles in perpetuating them. And then lastly, I think this has been very powerful. I think that the movement for Black Lives and the uprisings, this past summer, and which in many cases, you know, there were Black immigrants, whether it was in New York or Minneapolis or, any of the cities where they took place, Black immigrants were part of the frontline organizing for that. I think it's caused the immigrant rights movement to start to come to terms with its own anti-Blackness and the way that it's, you know, from the top of our leadership structures to, you know, what's in, you know, the way that our grassroots members absorb anti-Blackness from American culture and society and media and, you know, often, you know, or even from our own, you know, homelands, the way that they are permeated with anti-Black racism. I think that's a long overdue conversation, and it's starting to happen. It's starting to be catalyzed by these uprisings, especially over the past year.
These systems of oppression, and the far right is very intersectional, and in the way that they target our communities and the ways that they have made it really clear of who their targets are and why they're seeking to eviscerate and destroy our humanity as a people. And I think that the uprisings really made it apparent that we need each other now more than ever, and that our communities need to do some reckoning, need to have courageous conversations, hard conversations about racism and what that looks like within our communities, what that looks like within the LGBT community, the immigrant rights movement, Latinx, non-Black folks, who engage in anti-Blackness. And so what does that look like from a granular level in our homes, to our communities, to our organizing, to our messaging, who's left out, and always being open to accountability. And I think that we have so much work to do. The state is actively moving to criminalize our communities, has done so for many years. I think there's an opportunity to continue to unify our voices. It's been not just the uprisings here in the US, but around the world, where we've seen the far right employ tactics to consolidate power and to continue to marginalize and oppress people. We've seen our people stand up just, you know, recently, Peru, and seeing young people come out to really denounce the, you know, the ways that the government is corrupt and trying to address justice in this moment. So we have a long journey ahead of us, and this is definitely a marathon and not a sprint.
Thank you. I really want to, you know, express my appreciation for the three of you joining me today for this conversation. I certainly get a lot from it, and I hope you did too. And I hope those watching will be inspired by what you do and you know, be inspired hopefully to join you in the struggle. So thank you again for spending the time with me today.